I'm very glad to present this my new work about Maso Spindle, and I'm pretty anxious to show it the first time to all of you. This study started from clinical consideration. We know that the older adults have limitation in the ability to adapt to movements in the balance. There is also a postural sway increases with each decades of life. We know that there is also a greatest increase in postural sway in older adult. And there is also another data that suggests me to study the Maso Spindle. We know that in older adult tend to co-activate the antagonist muscle along with the agonist muscle at a given joint significantly more often respect to the youngest. So all that papers suggest to me that probably the Maso Spindle can become less sensitive with aging. And why I think about Maso Spindle? Because, for example, in the two very recent paper, affirm that the frequency of the bandwidth of the solute response became progressively narrowed with aging. And in this other review, they affirm that the mechanical vibration applied to single or few muscle are a selective stimulus for Maso Spindle. So if we have a changing in the response of mechanical vibration, probably there is also a change in the activation of the Maso Spindle. But what happened to the Maso Spindle with aging? We know surely that the Maso Spindle need to change the shape during the muscle contraction or during the stretching of a muscle. If the muscle is elongated, we have such a type of deformation of the Maso Spindle and the Maso Spindle can fire. At the contrary, if we want to, if we contract the Maso Spindle or if we short a muscle, the Maso Spindle is not able to fire. But the ability to feel the shortening and lengthening of the muscle is very sensitive, and a Maso Spindle threshold corresponds to a tension of 3 grams. So we need really to have a very adaptable structure all around the Maso Spindle to permit the Maso Spindle to lengthen and shortening and to fire at the proper tension of the muscle. But until now, we have studied always the Maso Spindle like that, so totally isolated to the environment. But we know that the Maso Spindle are totally embedded in the intramuscular connective tissue. And there are many papers and many descriptions in literature that the capsule of the Maso Spindle is just the perimysium of the muscle that split around the Maso Spindle and create the capsule of the Maso Spindle. This is one of my lucky pictures because we can see the Maso Spindle. This is the capsule, and we can see that is exactly the perimysium that is also in continuity with the epimysium in that case. But also here we can see the Maso Spindle and how it is totally in connection with the perimuscular tissue. But as Shenglei Fan will describe you later, between a young people and a elderly people, we have a totally different amount of connective tissue. If we can see that muscle or that muscle, and we can imagine that the Maso Spindle are in the perimysium, we can imagine that the ability, the sensibility of the Maso Spindle could be different in such that subject or in that subject, not because there is an alteration in the Maso Spindle, but because the environment where the Maso Spindle is inserted is totally different. So in this study, we take the leg of 15 mice And we divide the mice in the first group with, and we kill the mice at 6 weeks that correspond to the puberty of the human. Another group was killed at 8 months that correspond to a middle age. And the third group was killed at 2 years old that correspond to 70 years old in the human. For all these samples, we did different stains and also we check the amount of hyaluronan in the muscle. Here we can see the leg, a section of the leg of the mouse, and we say different, we did different staining, the hematoxylin eosin, the picrocerus red, the collagen type 1, collagen type 3 antibody, the HABP, that is for the hyaluronan. And then we check the we check all the muscle spindle in the section of the leg, and we describe the environment around the muscle spindle. So here we can see the picrocerus red, the hyaluronan binding protein, the collagen type 1, the collagen type 3, the S100, and here another stain. Then we check for each muscle spindle that we found in the mouse, the thickness of the outer layer of the capsule of the muscle spindle, and then the area around the muscle spindle. So we isolate that area and we calculate the amount of collagen fiber inside that area. So for example, here we define that area and we decide how many collagen fiber are in that specific area to avoid that the context of all the other muscle can affect our evaluation. First of all, we confirm that the capsule of a muscle spindle is totally in continuity with the perimysium of the muscle. Here we can clearly see the muscle spindle with the intramuscular bundle. This is the capsule of the muscle spindle, and you can see here how it is in continuity with the perimysium here or here. Again, another muscle spindle and the continuity through the muscle and in another section here. So surely the muscle spindle are embedded in the intramuscular connective tissue and the capsule of the muscle spindle is in continuity with the perimysium and the endomysium of the muscle. So when the muscle spindle have to change the shape to permit the contraction or to feel the tension of the muscle, the surrounding intramuscular connective tissue probably can affect the sensibility of the muscle spindle. Here we can see also a larger section of the leg, and we can see the muscle spindle in a smaller part and how it is totally connected with the perimysium of the muscle. So we can also suggest that probably the muscle spindle distribution could be related to the 3D arrangement of the intramuscular connective tissue. Indeed, we know that there are many different hypotheses about the muscle spindle distribution. Is related to the vascularization with the different type of muscular fiber and so on. But until now, it's not really clear why some muscle spindle are distributed more in the surface or more in the deeper part of the muscle and so on. One of my hypotheses that I needed surely to demonstrate better is that one of the elements is the organization of the intramuscular connective tissue that define also the position of the muscle spindle that became a specific receptor for the intramuscular connective tissue tension. But now we move on in the results. Here, there is the different aspect of a muscle at 6 weeks of demise and 2 years old. So again, we can see as the connective tissue increase in the different group. And if we compare the different group, but then Shengley will speak much better about that, we can see that there is an increased amount of connective tissue in the muscle. But we stay more focused in the muscle spindle. And we can also see as the thickness of the outer layer of the capsule change between the group A, the group B, and the group C, and become thicker and thicker. So I don't know exactly if it's become less sensitive, but surely we have an outer capsule that is thicker in the older people respect with the young. And if we check the total collagen content in the area around the muscle spindle, as I have shown you, we can see a huge increase of collagen fiber in that area. But and if and then I show you also the type of collagen fiber, because we compare the amount of collagen type 1 and the collagen type 3 in that surrounding area of the muscle spindle. And you can see here that the collagen type 1 increase in the different group. At the contrary, the collagen type 3 remain pretty constant. That data correspond also to the data that present Michael Kerr in the previous lecture. And he demonstrated that also in the tendon, the collagen type 3 has less variation respect to the collagen type 1. So we know also that the collagen type 3 is a more adaptable tissue. At the contrary, the collagen type 1 create a stiffer tissue. So probably an increased amount of collagen type 1 around the muscle spindle create a less sensitive muscle spindle. We check also the hyaluronan, because in the last year, I'm pretty focused in the hyaluronan amount and how it changes with aging. In the previous lecture, Professor Narici speak about the role of hydration for the mechanical properties of the tendon. I think that the hydration is really a key point, and the hyaluronan is the element that link the water in the intramuscular and extramuscular connective tissue. And here we can see as in the different group, we have a decrease of the hyaluronan, above all between the young and the old people. We have compared also in human, and we have seen that between middle age and old age, there is not a huge variation. But between very young people and old people, there is a huge variation. But why all that is important? During a discussion with Professor Mans in 2011, he affirmed that the structural disorder of a fascia can surely distort the information sent by muscle spindle to the central nervous system, and thus can interfere with proper coordinated movement. Particularly, the primary spindles afferent are so sensitive that even a slight distortion of the perimysium will change their discharge frequency. So also if the muscle spindle are healthy, if our central nervous system are healthy, if the environment where the muscle spindle are located can affect the sensibility of the muscle spindle and consequently to create proper coordinated movement. So to conclude, we can affirm that if we have a muscle spindle with more connective tissue around, with a thicker capsule, it's possible, and surely we can better demonstrate with the physiological study that hypothesis that the muscle spindle can become less sensitive to elongation.
And 5 minutes left.
And that can create a postural control failure and consequently an increased risk to fall. but is also possible a second event. So the gamma input can't shorten the mass of spindle because the mass of spindle is like embedded in a very rigid structure. And consequently, there is a failing in the motor unit recruitment. And that can decrease the activation of a motor unit that may accomplish a decrease in contractile strength of the muscle. So it's just a change of view that can probably complete the picture that we are done in that Congress. Thank you so much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Professor Stecco, for this very interesting and stimulating presentation on changes in muscle spindles as affected by aging. And the floor is open to questions. I have one question myself, but I'd like to let others go first. Any questions?
Yes.
Please, Professor Angelini.
Yes, I enjoyed very much the talk by Carla Stecco and my experience with spindles are that you can see them occasionally in muscle biopsies. And I'm really naive about their changes and enjoy the fact that you saw changes in the surrounding, the collagen and all the components. I wonder two things, First thing is that last slide you showed that this can change also the input, and sometimes we can see in some condition, a type 1 to type 2 transition in muscle fibers due to different condition, dystrophy, exercise and so on. So I wonder if this you think has an importance in type 1 to 2 changes in the motor neuron innervation. The other question is quite naive. What determines the number of muscle inside the spindle? What is the main determinant?
I'm sorry, I was not able to hear the question.
I mean, you see sometime the first or the last?
No, the last sentence, there was a problem in the connection.
The last sentence is number of fibers you see in the muscle spindle. Sometimes you see more, sometimes less. What is the reason?
Yes, as you can see in that picture, usually we have found 4, 5, 6. Yes. But it was not the topic of the research. So to be honest, we don't count exactly the number of intrafusal muscle fiber in our
bags and two different types.
Yes, but we don't focus in the...
I understand. So what about the retroaction on the muscle by the collagen?
I don't know. I'm very curious to understand what can happen in that aspect. But it's a preliminary study, so it's just the first idea to introduce also such a topic in the discussion of the muscle, but we don't back also the muscle around. I'm sorry.
Any more questions?
I can.
Yes, Professor Kerr.
Yeah. Thanks very much, Carla, for that presentation. Where do you see physical activity come in here? Because I assume that the animal model that they were running voluntarily or something, because this is really interesting. Because if there is a role, there is for the spindles, where does exercise come in, especially when you try to suggest that age-related changes in collagen might overrule or at least control the ability by the spindle to do what it should do. So where do you see exercise comes in here? I mean,
I think that the exercise can surely avoid such a type of evolution, because if our mice were just live in with the free activity without any specific input. But I'm very curious to do a model with specific activity, because I think that that can really change such type of evolution. I have also speak with Paul Hodging about that, and he is looking in the sheep model of back pain about that. And also that could be a new aspect, because I think that is a pathological condition that we need to avoid.
Thank you.
If I may ask a question, Carla.
Yes.
We know that with aging, the tendon tap reflex decreases, and also the H reflex decreases. So do you think that the decrease in sensitivity of the spindle may play a role in these decreases?
Yes, I think so.
Reflex response.
Exactly, is the aim of that research. Surely we need to add a more clinical study, and if it will be possible to collaborate with you about that, will be great, because I think that actually is just an hypothesis. So we have found such type of changing. Now we need to understand exactly what happened if, for example, we stimulate in a different way, the electrical way, the muscle spindle, if there is a delay in the answer. We can really do different studies to demonstrate if the muscle spindle became less sensitive. And it's just the beginning, I'm sorry.
Yes, of course. No, we'll be easily do some studies with you on the tendon tap reflex.
Perfectly.